Chris here with a Windows 11 Pro mini PC. This is the Mini's Forum UM590. The 690, that is coming. It's currently stuck in customs. And that's got, of course, the Ryzen 9, the 6900HX that everyone is probably after more than this particular model here, which this one is the lower spec version because it's now last gen. It does have the Ryzen 9 5900HX. So 4.6 gigahertz, maximum turbo, 8 cores, 16 threads. It has liquid metal in here and a new cooling system, new body, and a more compact design compared to, say, the HX90 and the HX90G that I have also reviewed. So my configuration comes with 16 gigabytes of RAM. Of course, it is DDR4 spec. We get DDR5 in the newer model, which I will be covering soon, and a 512 gigabyte PCIe 3 SSD in this model here. It does have Wi-Fi 6E, which is the latest spec, 2.5 gigabit LAN, and I'll be covering it in detail, let you know the performance and what you can expect out of this little mini PC, including power consumption, thermals, and anything else that does pop up in this review. Included in the box, you will find a user guide. So that is the installation of the 2.5 inch drive, how to access the internals, the ports, etc. There is this, a warning. So they are using liquid metal. I'm not going to be removing it. So I'll keep the factory setup. So exactly how it came out of the box is what I will be reviewing when it comes to the thermals. We have a VESA mounting bracket, our power supply cable. So this cable, the plug, is very easy to source a replacement. It's common. This is what desktop PC power supplies use. The power supply, nice, reasonably small size to it. It is 120 watts. We do have a SATA 3 cable for the 2.5 inch drive, a stand for the mini PC. You don't have to use this, but we have that option. An HDMI cable, and finally, two rubber feet. Now this mini PC has a very compact design considering it's packing a lot of power. So this model has the Ryzen 9, the 5900HX, 8 cores, 16 threads. But there is a model that I will be reviewing very shortly because it's currently stuck in customs. And that is the Ryzen 9 6900HX model. So we have a reset here for the CMOS power on button with status LED, 3.5 millimeter headphone jack. This is type C, so this is USB 3.2. Gen 2. We have another one that supports display out, and you can run three displays with this. So intake vent right here. On this side, we have an exit vent. There is another exit vent there at the back, and then another two display outs here. So 4K 60 on all three. This is HDMI 2.0, two of them, 2.5 gigabit LAN power in, and another two USB 3.2 Gen 2s here. And then two USB 2. So this will be good for a mouse and keyboard. Kensington lock slot right there. The top of it, we have the Mini's Forum logo right here on a little bit of silver. So this is plastic for the wireless antenna reception. The whole build of it is plastic, but it does feel good. On this side, there's another intake vent there. And then along the bottom, you'll find two rubber feet, the big ones. We've got replacements, and then we have two little small ones, and then the mounting points there for the VESA mount if you wanted to put it onto the back of a monitor. Now, in order to gain access to the internals, you need to remove the little rubber feet here. So there's that one you need to remove, the other, and if you just lift this up or take it from the corner, probably is a bit easier, you can simply remove those rubber feet, and then you'll find the other screw hole there. So there's four in total. I'll remove those screws and I'll show you the internals. All right, so with those removed, there is a little gap here you can see on the bottom, and using a pry tool, I've already just popped that up, and then you should just be able to pry it up like so and completely remove it, and then you can see our internals. So they've gone with brand components here, known brand, 8.8 of the RAM. So this is 3.2 gigahertz DDR4. Now the newer model, of course, has the better spec because the new model's got DDR5 at 4.8 gigahertz. You also have USB 4 spec. It can run external displays, and it also does have a PCIe 4 spec SSD. Now this model does not. This is PCIe 3.0, so slower speeds there, And I believe it's a Kingston drive they are using, but I will check that out now. And the wireless card is underneath it. No, our M.2 SSD here, so PCIe 3.0 spec, is a Intel one. I can see right there the Intel brand. And the performance of it, I will let you know later on in this review. So it does have a heatsink thermal pad on there, which is good to help cut down on the throttling because these do get hot. And if you're wondering where the 2.5-inch drive goes, well, this is where you will screw that into place. You can see that we've got the mounting points right there. You can see, okay, so that's going to screw on and sit here. You just slot it into one side and then two screws right there. And the cable for it, that plugs in, that SATA 3 cable, where are we? Right here on the motherboard too. So you plug that in and then you can install that. So you can expand upon the storage, which is good. You can add even a spindle hard drive with a very large capacity. And our wireless card here is from MediaTek. It's Wi-Fi 6E spec. So this is our BIOS, and unfortunately it is very locked down. There's not a lot of available options to us really. So we have hardware monitor, you can adjust the fan profiles there, tweak that if you wanted to do so, but I would probably just leave that. Power configuration, there's not anything here you'd really want to change, maybe the resume on LAN or wake by RTC. We've got then this AMD CBS. Now under this, you normally find power limit options, but unfortunately locked down to us. So really we have this thermal control that you wouldn't touch anyway. You leave that on auto and audio configuration. And then our FCH common options, SATA configuration options, and then AC power loss options. So this is good. At least we've got this option. If you're going to run it as a server or on a switch or something, you want to set that to always on there, but I'd leave it as is. So really there's no need for you to go in here unless you're going to change the boot order options. Now this UM590, like the 690, does ship with Windows 11 and it is the pro version. So I have 16 gigabytes of RAM and you'll see that a little bit of that is actually used up, okay? Because we've got some dedicated to the Vega 8 graphics, which runs at 2.1 gigahertz. More on that later on when I check out the gaming performance. So the SSD in this model is, as I showed you before, when we looked at the internals, it is an Intel, it is PCIe 3.0, and the speeds aren't wonderful. Okay, you can see they're pretty average there. Now the retail versions, the next version that's sent out, this is basically an early version that I've got, will have, apparently according to Mini's Forum, faster SSDs. So the speed, okay, isn't amazing for the writes, but yes, it is faster than SATA 3, and you could upgrade and put a Samsung 970 Evo into this if you wanted, of course, a little bit faster. Now, I do have a couple of benchmarks that I'll just quickly show you here. So you can see Geekbench 5, very good score. It's got the 8 cores, 16 threads. Now, the newer model with the Ryzen 6000 series, the 6900HX, will be a little faster, but it's not apparently a huge difference. We're looking around like 10% or so faster than this, but you get the USB 4, you get the PCIe 4.0 spec, which is good. Now, closer look here at some of the details of this particular APU. You see that it does clock up to 4.6 gigahertz. It's based off the 7 nanometer process right there, and as mentioned, the 16 threads. So it's still a monster. Now this one's configured to the default power limit, which is the 45 watts. And how I know this? Well, because I've been monitoring it here with HW Info. You see right here that it has not gone over 45 watts here, the power that it is pulling. Now the maximum I'm seeing at the wall with a wall meter I've got is 78 watts under full load. And at idle, it is about, well, right now it's 7.9, just looking at it and bumping or hovering around kind of 9, 8, 10, and it's just under light load. So under idle, pretty good power consumption, and even full load, not too bad there. You'll see the temperatures, thermals are good. Now, being a smaller unit, I was expecting the thermals probably not to be so great. I was expecting maybe thermal throttling, maybe 98 degrees or something like that. But no, look at this, maximum is just over 80 degrees. Now we've got, of course, the liquid metal in here. I think that's helping, and they're cooling with the heat pipes, the way it is sucking in cool air from two sides and then blasting it out the back and then the side, I think is working really well. So good cooling, fan noise acceptable. You don't really hear it. It's only when under load you hear it, and then the fan noise quickly dies away. Most of the time when it's not in use, it is very quiet. You can hardly even hear the fan. Now, if I gave you a sample, you'd hear my tower PC more than the actual mini PC. So it's a big thumbs up from me on the thermals and the fan noise here, which are excellent. And finally, just to show you one more benchmark, that is Cinebench R23. You can see we do get a very good score here for this type of chipset, being basically a mobile chipset and a mini PC, 45 watts. This is excellent. Now, it could do better if it was configured to 54 watts, the power limit, but unfortunately, I cannot change that in the BIOS. How was the video playback? So I am here in YouTube and I am streaming 4K 60. This is the VP9 codec that it is using here within Chrome. And you can see it dropped 23 frames. Now that was just at the beginning when I resized the video from a small box into full screen. That is normal that it will do that. So it drops no frames here, flawless playback of streaming of 4K 60, which is excellent. Then HEVC, so this is 160 megabits per second. Again, flawless. So the Vega 8 graphics clocked at 2.1 gigahertz has no issues. This does not stress out the APU at all. So the Ryzen 9 5900HX, this mini PC, the UM590, is a perfect media playback device. It has sufficient power, in fact, overkill power, really, for these kind of video playback needs. A VP9, HEVC, 4K, high bit rates, not a problem at all. Now, could you edit video? 4K video, my timeline consists of some Sony files here that are 100 megabits per second, 4K, HEVC, and the timeline, the playback is smooth. There doesn't seem to be a problem, but I do have a quarter resolution set here for the playback resolution, which I would do because we don't have a dedicated GPU with this spec of mini PC. Of course, it's the Vega graphics here, but it fares well for basic 4K edits. You can do this, all right? Now, my timeline here is about 10 minutes long. It doesn't seem to be choppy, laggy, unbearable to edit, but bear in mind, I'm not color grading here or doing any fancy transitions or anything. Let's have a look at the export times now with Adobe Premiere Pro. This, by the way, is the 2023 version. So it's the latest one with the latest enhancements, and it does support hardware acceleration for decoding and encoding video. The preset I'm using is the YouTube 4K. Now this is only 40 megabits per second it will be encoding at, but it'd be interesting to see how long it is going to take. So 1 minute of footage only, hit start right here and then export. It should not take long at all. It should be tearing through this. So you can see that it's barely using the GPU, integrated GPU, AMD Vega graphics, only at 11%. It's the CPU doing most of it, but this is really screaming ahead. And let's skip now to the end result. So there we go. It is about to finish up and it just did. So safe to say about 37 seconds for 1 minute of footage. It's factoring in my little delay there to hit the export button. So that is excellent performance. So these basic 4K edits in Adobe Premiere Pro, yes, you can do with this spec of mini PC, even with the 16 gigabytes of RAM. Then onto our gaming. So it should be able to do around 70 frames per second average, the Vega 8 graphics here, if it holds the 2100 megahertz clock. Which it is, you can see, it's doing well. So it's about 60 frames per second, 65 there on average. So not quite 70, that's probably around the best I've seen it, but this is about Iris Xe level of graphics here for integrated graphics, that is, and it's looking very good. So this is in the car, rendering, of course, quite a few more polygons and everything here, the shadows and the textures. So just get out again. And you'll see that, yeah, we're up to 80 here. So good performance. 1080p is what I'm running GTA 5 at right here. And, you know, this is perfectly playable. It is, yes, an old title. A great title at that. And I'm pretty sure everyone out there knows about this game and has played it. But yeah, looking very good. You can see with the motorbike, the frame rate is actually a little better here. So that's great. Then stepping it up with a title that is really demanding. This is Cyberpunk 2077. Now I've got it set to the lowest preset. And even at lowest, the game still looks really good, but the resolution I had to drop down to 720p. At 1080p, you only get around 25, 24 frames per second. It's just too choppy. So this looks excellent. It's got a lot to render here. Look at all of the shaders, the reflections on the ground, and everything that is going on here. That is impressive for integrated graphics to be able to get a frame rate here with so many NPCs around, cars and everything on screen, of a very playable over 30 frames per second. I mean, this is better than consoles. This is better than the PlayStation 4, PlayStation 4 Pro, rendering a lot more and still maintaining a decent enough frame rate for integrated graphics, that is. Then Linux support, well, good news, working just fine. I have booted a USB pen drive here, a live boot image of Linux Manjaro. Now, I use the open source drivers because I do find that they tend to pretty much find the driver for everything, and including this wireless card from MediaTek. I thought it might have issues, but no, it is working. So everything seems to work fine. If you intend to run Linux on this mini PC, you should be okay. I roll the UM590 is an excellent mini PC, so great fan noise, good thermals. It offers display out up to three displays at 4K, and I really cannot fault it. It's got a lot on offer, the 2.5 gigabit LAN, Wi-Fi 6E, and performance-wise for its size is really quite good. And I'm surprised that the Vega graphics held up really well. It held that turbo at the 2.1 gigahertz the whole entire time. You could get a decent playable frame rate out of a demanding game like even Cyberpunk 2077 that I showed you, but of course, running only at 720p. Now, I will have soon the UM690 model, which is the step above this one, because it's got the latest APU there from AMD. So it has the Ryzen 9, the 6900HX, so it's faster, up to 4.9 gigahertz. Still has the same 8-core, 16 threads, but the big change is it does have a new integrated GPU. So it is the 680M, clocked faster, but the newer model does also support DDR5 RAM, PCIe 4 and USB 4 spec 2, which can run external display. So it's probably the model to go for. Subscribe and do check out the review of that, which hopefully will be coming maybe the end of this week or next week there, so do check for that in my channel. And thanks a lot for watching my review of the UM590, another amazing, really good mini PC, a solid offering from Minis Forum.